place in a long time. Merry Christmas. Yeah. We should. Yeah. Thank you for always sitting in the front row. Yeah. I like it.
Welcome to our service. We're glad you're here to join us and worship with us today. If you're new to Journey, a special welcome. We're excited that you chose us to be a part of your Christmas morning. We hope this time blesses you and your family. Let's go ahead and stand to our feet. I'm going to open us with a word of prayer, and we will get into these songs this morning. Father, we thank you for your son. We thank you for the birth. We thank you that we have the freedom to come here and celebrate together as a church family. And we thank you for this season. And we know that this season is not always the most joyful time. It's not always the most wonderful time of the year for people. So I just think of those that are hurting right now. I think of those that are dealing with loss. I think of those that are struggling financially. I just pray that everyone would be touched by your Holy Spirit in a special way this morning, whether it's through these songs, through the truth in your word, through the fellowship we have with one another, through the love that you've given each one of us. Our prayer is that we would each be surrounded by that love this morning, and we'd feel your presence with us as we sing and worship you. We want to give you all the praise and all the glory. In your name, amen. Amen. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. give God some praise. Amen? Amen. Father, we thank you and we praise you this morning. It's a morning of celebration. We're here to adore you. We're here to worship you. And we're here to thank you for the freedom and the joy that we have in your Son. We give you all of our hearts this morning. And all God's people said, amen and amen. You may be seated. And we're going to take some time to hear from our kids and their worship experience this well this week.
Bye. If I could speak all the languages of earth and of angels, but didn't speak of love to others, I would only be a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. So 'tis the season to give gifts to our loved ones, to maybe people we don't know, but it's the season to give. And it reminds me of the greatest gift that we've all been given, and that is new life, that is forgiveness, and that is grace by the one and only Jesus Christ. And we've been given other blessings and other gifts from him throughout our lives. So at this point, since it is his birthday, I would like to give him a gift back, and maybe you can enjoy it as well.
Good morning and Merry Christmas, everybody. I'm not aware of how to take this off, and I don't want to break it, so I'm going to stay. Okay, I'm going to stay right here. For all of you that don't know me, I am Liz Boyer, and I have the honor and the joy of leading the kids ministry. I'm going to do announcements, but I don't know if there are slides that are supposed to be coming up. No? I'll just talk from, okay. So we have our connection card, and honestly, that's just a way that we can connect with you as a church so that we can pray for you if you have any praises that you want to report about. I am the most reluctant person on asking for prayer, but just to set my pride aside, anytime I ask for prayer at church, it is always in confidence. And just the beauty of somebody asking on your behalf to have prayer. And also, I had a son, a 9-year-old son, who just got baptized, but the reason why his coming to Jesus was for an answered prayer. So we love to hear when you guys have answered prayers and when you want prayers. So, and we also have a warrior prayer team that comes every Tuesday evening. And if you want to help get connected with that, you can talk with Adrian or myself or any of the staff here. So we just love to pray for you guys. You guys can do it through the app or even the connection card that's on the back of your guys' chair. And also, sorry guys, I had some notes. And so I wrote way too much things that I do not want to say. But we are going to have a fasting and prayer, 21 days. So that starts January 8th through the 28th. And the first time that I did this was probably a couple years ago. And the boys on the team, because I have a staff full of just boys, and they joke, oh, we're going to take out water and food for 21 days. I'm like, no, please, please do not do that. Just think of something that you do, something that you don't need, something that kind of takes up mindless, occupied time that you could be using elsewhere, and you just replace it with prayer and just kind of watch how God works in your life. Some things that I've done in the past was like take away social media or Facebook, or maybe you just spend those times with your family using that as prayer time. So that is one thing, or maybe taking TV away. So that starts January 8th for 21 days. I am super excited to kind of hear what your guys' stories are and how God worked in your life. Next week, we have only one service again, so it will be at 10 a.m., just kind of like today. We will offer care for elementary as well, so we're going to kind of have like a movie day with hot cocoa and just something really fun for the kids and also for the little ones too. So do not miss that. And you know what? You know when your phone turns off and you have to use your Face ID and then it doesn't calculate it because you have a microphone in your face? That's kind of what I'm experiencing right now. And at the end of the service, like, do not leave, because we want to just bless your children with a gift that we handpicked out for them. So please do not leave. The last 15 minutes, we're going to invite all of the elementary and all the ones in their 0 to 5 years just to come on stage and be able to open a gift. And I would like to pray for Jason before we come. So pray with me, please. Father God, I just want to humbly come to you and just pray that what Jason says today, that it just touches our hearts and that we are able to apply it to our lives. And through the chaos and the busyness of this season, Lord, remind us to just focus in on you and remind us that you are of love and you are of peace. And I pray that we have some spiritual healing, because there's a lot of illnesses, but there's a lot of illnesses in the heart. And Lord, I just ask you to heal those people in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, thank you, Liz. Well, good morning. Merry Christmas, everybody. Merry Christmas. I also want to say, he is risen. He is, but wrong day. Okay. He is born. He is born indeed. All right. Well, we had some mic issues this morning, so we're all sharing the same mic here. But we'll get through all of these things. We're so glad that you're here this morning, that you got out of the ice storm this morning and made it down here. It's a special day. I think the next time we do Christmas together on a Sunday is in 11 years. So this is kind of a once-in-a-decade kind of a thing that we get to do. So very exciting to be here, very exciting to give this message this morning. I think it's very practical for where we're at as a country, where we're at as a congregation, and just a state as in general. But before we get into that, would you guys pray with me as we prepare our hearts to hear the word this morning? Father, we are so thankful this morning that you sent your son. As we think about Christmas and all the Christmases we've celebrated before, God, we are appreciative of God, everything that you've done, everything that you will do. So, Father, as we are here this morning to celebrate you, God, would you show up today? Would you change our lives yet again through your word? God, be with us this service. Let your spirit speak through me, that we all may leave changed today. And open our ears to hear, our eyes to see. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Christmas is here, And we've put up the lights, and maybe some of you guys started doing that end of November. So it's been like this month-long process of getting to Christmas. The lights are up. The presents are mostly in from Amazon. And maybe you guys opened most of them this morning, except the ones that aren't quite here yet. And so we've gone through this huge process, right? There's this anticipation. There's this music that we listen to only this time of year. And some people only listen to Christmas music this time of year. They forsake all other music for this month, the season, to specify specific types of music. It's a huge deal, isn't it? Christmas season, stores start having sales as soon as Thanksgiving is over. We kind of just get through Thanksgiving, right, so that we can get on to Christmas, decorating for that, celebrating for that. And there's this anticipation. There's this celebration that we're waiting for. We wait for this day to come. And then blink, it's over. And my wife commented to me about a week ago. She's like, man, Christmas is almost over, and we haven't even sat by the tree and watched a movie yet, a Christmas movie. And so, like, we're busy. There's so much going on, and we can't wait for this day. It's all preparation for this one day. And then it's over. And if you're like me, I enjoy the anticipation before almost more than the event sometimes. Because that way you know it's still coming. It's not over yet. Sometimes, like, as soon as it's actually there, you're like, man, it's almost over. And you start to get a little bit disappointed because it's actually happening. You're like, wait, this is why we were waiting for what we were waiting for in the first place. And maybe, and I know Christmas is hard for some people. I get that. I don't want to think that Christmas is awesome for everyone. But for most people, it's a wonderful time of year. But then as it wraps up and later today, maybe we're celebrating with family, we're eating a meal, and then it kind of sets in that it's over. You're like, man, what now? What do we do now? Do you ever get disappointed after Christmas? Do you ever get disappointed like it's over? It was so awesome. We waited so long for it. We prepped so much, and now it's over. What do we do? Maybe we even get depressed as we look forward and think, man, we've got to make it through January and February before, like, anything exciting happens again. And we get depressed a little bit. We get sad. We're disappointed. Maybe this feeling of hopelessness. As soon as we eat dinner tonight with our families, maybe we're doing some celebration later today, and you finish your plate of food, and you think, man, all I have to do now is clean the dishes, take down the lights, and take out all the wrapping paper and decide if we're going to save the bows or not this year, right? That's all you have to look forward to. And maybe you get a little bit hopeless because of that. Everything's over. Everything's done. What now? What do we do now? It seems like there was so much built up, so much looking forward to this moment, and it passes like a car on the highway, and it's over. And sometimes we feel depressed. We feel hopeless after the fact. I love how Adrian put it yesterday about this hope and peace that we have in, like, Christmas Eve service. And then as soon as we leave the service, we feel hopeless again. We don't feel that peace anymore. The anxiety comes back to us. So that's my question for you this morning. Do you ever get disappointed? Do you ever get depressed after Christmas? Do you feel hopeless as soon as it's over? All of our hope and dreams for the last month has gone into today. But what happens when today's over? What do we do? What do we look forward to? The next celebration to have? The next birthday? The next holiday that we have? Or is there something else to look forward to? And that's what we're going to talk about today. We've been looking through the names of Jesus. And we're going to look at one more for this Christmas series. And I wanted to briefly recap some of the other names. We looked through Wonderful Counselor, right? The one who gives us counsel, the God who comes, brings us his wisdom from a place of authority. And this wisdom that is wonderful, it's too great for words. Mighty God, this mighty God who is God himself, who comes to us in all his strength and offers that to us to help us. Everlasting Father, the God who is the good Father, right? He is a fatherly figure to us, like a father is supposed to be, who treats us as the children of God that we are. The Prince of Peace, the one who is sent to bring us the peace of God. Right, we looked at these, and we have one more, and this comes from Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. I believe we have a slide for this as well. But as I was thinking of what to talk on today, this was actually the first slide that Adrian brought up in the Christmas series way back in the beginning of December. And I was like, this is exactly what we need to talk about. So this is what it says. All right, therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. All right, again, so some historical context on this. Judah was under attack, right? The nations were trying to come and take over them, and so God actually offers him a sign to show that he's going to be faithful to his people. And what happens is Hezekiah doesn't actually ask for a sign, so God's like, okay, I'm just going to give you one. There's going to be a virgin, and she's going to have a son. And as we keep reading in the narrative of Isaiah in chapter 8, this actually gets partially fulfilled. There's a son born in chapter 8. And essentially what God is doing here, and he does this all the time as we read our prophets in the Old Testament, God actually says, hey, this is what I'm going to do in the future, but so that you know you can trust me, I'm going to do a sign now. Right? And so he does this kind of like immediate sign that's connected with the one in the future so that they know God is good on his word, that he's actually going to fulfill what he promised in the future because he does something immediately for them. And so in chapter 8, we actually see that this happens. There's this son born, and he's given a special name as well. And what he's doing there is God saying, see, I did this so that you can trust what I'm going to do in the future. Right now, Emmanuel, it means God with us, right? And this is an important promise, right? Because all those other names of God, they're great, but if he's not with us, that doesn't do much for us, right? If he's this awesome, wonderful counselor, but he's distant from us, that doesn't help us at all. If he's mighty God and loves us like a father is supposed to, but right, he's a distant father, that doesn't do anything for us. We need God with us in order to for him to fulfill everything that he says he's going to be. All right, so let's look at this idea of God with us this morning, on the morning where we celebrate Jesus being born, and look at kind of the biblical story of how this happened. So we're going to kind of walk Genesis through Revelation, hopefully somewhat quick, and look at this man. And look at this main thread going through the Bible of the story of God with us. And it all starts in Genesis chapter 1, right? God creates the universe. He creates the world, not so he can stand back and just let us do our thing, but so that he can be with us. Right, this is why he creates us. He creates us to be with us, to have a relationship with us, and this is exactly how it is in Eden. God is with his people. He's walking with them. He created us to be with him, and we see this in the beginning. They're with God. They're walking with him. God is with them. And he sets up boundaries, just like any good relationship, right? And this is what we see as laws and do's and don'ts. God is setting up boundaries, saying, hey, if we're going to have a relationship, there's going to have to be some ground rules for this. And he says, the only rule at this point, don't eat of this tree. You can have everything else. Don't eat of this one tree. But what do? They eat of that one tree. And they separate themselves from God, right? And the word in the Bible is death, right? Death is often not necessarily seen as just a physical death, but it's seen as separation. I want us to think of death as separation as we read the Bible, because that's what it is. It's a separation from God. They didn't die physically immediately, but they were separated from the presence of God. And so God is no longer with us as he was before that. There's this separation now. So what is God's response to this? He immediately starts a plan in order to get his people back to him. This is Genesis chapter 3, 15. Right? He says this, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring, and he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. Right, and this is the first pronouncement, Genesis, right, page 3 of our Bibles, that God has a plan to return to his people sometime in the future. And there's not much here, right? And knowing the rest of the story, we can kind of read this and get what's going on. They probably had absolutely no idea what this was, right? And so, but this is the start of God's plan to reunite himself with his people. But for now, they're still separated. Their sin has separated them from God. God is not with them anymore. Then in Genesis chapter 12, God calls Abraham, or Abram at the time, and says, hey, I am going to start a special people with you. Why? Because Abraham was so awesome. He was so faithful to God. No, actually, I think it's Hebrews tells us he was worshiping other gods at the time. No, because God is faithful to his promises. He says, I'm going to choose you to be to make a people out of you. And you are going to be my special people. And so we see God is starting this relational thing back with his people. He's starting this relationship again with his people in Genesis chapter 12. Well, we get through the breaths of the book of Genesis, and we see Joseph goes down to Egypt. They start multiplying. They become this great nation, but they become enslaved. Right? They're not in the land God promises to Abraham. They're not in the right spot. They're slaves. They're not free to worship God. And so Exodus comes along, and in Exodus, Moses is there. And Moses, God uses Moses to free the people from slavery. And what does he do? He says, hey, come out of Egypt and come to Mount Sinai. Why? Because that's where God is going to reveal his presence. God says, I want to meet with you here. And this is going to be the first time that God meets with his people since Genesis chapter 2. And it's this special moment as we get into like Exodus 19 and chapter 20. And God says, hey, you guys are going to be my special people. You're going to come to the mountain and I'm going to reveal myself there. And essentially what happens, there's a lot of things that happen in these chapters, but essentially the people come up, they see the presence of God on the mountain and they're scared and they say, Moses, you go up, you talk to God and come back down and tell us what he says. Right, so this is the pattern that gets established. Moses goes into the presence of God. He comes out. He tells the people what God says. This is where we get the Ten Commandments. This is where we get the rest of the laws of the Old Testament. Moses is going into the presence of God and coming and telling the people. Again, this is God establishing his covenant. It's a relational covenant saying, hey, I will be your God and you will be my people. God is working on restoring this relationship with people. Right, and so he goes, he gets this, and great, again, the people continually fall away. The people continually don't always listen to it. And so what happens is they get this Ark of the Covenant, and they get these plans for the tabernacle. And this tabernacle, they set this up, and this represents God with his people. Right, and so God's presence actually dwells within the tent so that it could be, in essence, God with us. Now it's confined. God's not with us everywhere like it was in the garden. God is confined into this box because that's right. That's how he chose to be. He said, my presence will be here. And again, it's this once a year the high priest can go into the Holy of Holies. Right? This isn't complete God with us. This is just a way for God to start that relationship with his people again. And so he sets up this tabernacle, and eventually they get the temple. And it's this solid building in one spot where God's presence rests in Jerusalem. But again, right, the high priest can only go in once a year. Right, and if you read the stories in Leviticus, it's kind of a sketchy interaction. He has to do these things very correctly. If he messes up just one time and doesn't do the right thing while he's in the Holy of Holies, he will die. Right, so actually what they would do is they would tie a rope around his ankle with some bells. In case he does die, they don't go in there to get the body and they die. They would just pull him out. Right, and actually historical records show that when the high priest would go and complete this well and survive, he would throw like a one-week party because he's so happy that he lived. Right, so they would celebrate like with no stops for like the whole week afterwards. Because like, I did it. Yeah, I didn't die. Right, so it's this God with us, but not fully. There's still some gaps. There's still some things holding us back. The relationship isn't completely restored yet, but God is starting to make his way. All right, so then, again, most of the rest of the Old Testament is this story. God's people fall away. They stop following him, right? They have this relational covenant where he says, if you obey me, I will be your God, you will be my people. They continually disobey, and it's more than disobedience. It's rejection of God and saying, we're going to worship other gods. We're going to do things our way. We're going to do whatever we want and actually kind of forget about God and leave him. Right? And so God sends them out of the land. They go into slavery again. His presence actually leaves the temple. We read this in Ezekiel chapter 10. Right? His presence actually leaves them during this time. Right? And so this is kind of the rest of that Old Testament. They go into slavery again. They go and get kicked out of the land that God has promised to give them. God's presence actually leaves them in the way that it is in the temple. And in this process of them getting kicked out of the land, getting destroyed by other armies, and God leaving the temple, this is where we get all our prophecies of the Old Testament. Because during when this is happening, when God is in an essence almost leaving them, God is saying, I'm not leaving you forever. My plan is still going on. I'm still going to restore us completely. And this is where we get Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. There will be a virgin who bears a son, and his name will be God with us. And as they're seeing God leaving the temple, as they're in exile, walking to Babylon, and they're in this captivity, they have this promise of God with us. Better than the temple, better than the tabernacle, better than sitting at the foot of Mount Sinai, this promise of God with us. And so they look for this. They wait for this. And we get to the New Testament in Matthew chapter 1. Do I have this up here? Yes. I forgot what slides I put up. Right, it says this. And so Matthew is detailing out the birth of Jesus Christ. And he says this, and all of this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken to the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel. And then he puts in parentheses because he's writing in Greek now, which means God with us. Right, in case they didn't pick up on that, right? So he's writing this account of this genealogy, essentially from Adam all the way to Jesus. And he says, oh, hey, by the way, this was to fulfill the prophecy of God with us. Matthew wants to make this very clear as we start our New Testaments, that this is what we have been waiting for ever since Isaiah, ever since Genesis chapter 3. We've been waiting for God with us, and he's making sure we don't miss this. The first page of our New Testament, this is the fulfillment of that. All right, so then Jesus comes. Right, we get these stories in Luke of John the Baptist leaping for joy in the womb, right? They're both in the womb, and we get this baby leaping for joy because he recognizes the presence of God with us. We get these stories where he's born, he fulfills all the prophecies, mostly in ways people didn't expect. But he fulfills these prophecies. He loves people as only God could love people. He walks with humans in flesh. This is truly God with us. It reminds me of Exodus chapter 33, verse 20. It says, you shall not see God and live. And then we have this anomaly of Jesus Christ, who is God in the flesh, and people are interacting with him every single day, and they're living. And in fact, he's giving them life as they see God with us. And again, this is the Christmas story that we're celebrating today, this morning, that Jesus came in the flesh to be God with us. Right? Imagine this moment. That you see Jesus in the flesh. You've heard the stories for hundreds of years, waiting for God to be with us, waiting for this prophecy to be fulfilled, and then it happens in front of your eyes, and you are amazed. You get to see God. Right? And then Jesus dies on the cross, and they're kind of like, what's going on here? He pays for our sins to reunite us with God spiritually. But then he gets even better. He raises from the dead and comes back to us. and he spends over a month with them, and he's just celebrating with them, but then he leaves. Right? God with us for a while, and then he left. And there's this moment as he's going back up into the clouds that his disciples were confused, and it probably felt a lot like December 26th for them. God was here. God was with us. That these promises fulfilled that we've been waiting for thousands of years. But then he left. It's over. He walked with us. He did miracles. But he left again. What's up with that? Right? And there's this confusion. But only for a minute. And we won't read the account in Acts. You can read in Acts chapter 1 of how they are comforted of these things. And then they remembered these words. So for the rest of our time, we're going to look at what gave them hope. We're going to look at why they had hope after Jesus physically left the earth. Because their hope is the same hope that we have. Right? God came in flesh, and then he left. What hope do we have? We're going to look at that right now. The first one that we're going to look at is John chapter 14, verses 1 through 4, and it says this. So this is Jesus talking to his disciples before he goes to the cross in that whole last week. He says this, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also, and that you know the way to where I am going." Right? And then a couple of verses later in this, right, this is where Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Right, and so we get these words from Jesus before he actually dies on the cross, before he raises from the dead. He actually tells his disciples, "I am going to leave, but I'm not going to stay gone forever. I'm going to prepare a place for you that I'm going to come back and take you to be with me forever." Right, and this is the hope that the disciples, as they watched Jesus disappear into the clouds, this is what they were looking forward to. This is what gave them hope the next day. This is what gave them hope as soon as Jesus left them, that they knew he wasn't leaving forever. He was going to prepare a place for them, come back, get his people, and never leave them again. Right, this is the ultimate fulfillment of Emmanuel, God with us. Right, again, there's this partial fulfillment in Isaiah chapter 8 to show that we could trust God. There's this major cap of fulfillment in Jesus' life, but it wasn't completed because he left us. And he's going to fulfill it fully, finally and forever, when he returns again. Now, I do want to say a quick side note. Yes, Jesus left us the Holy Spirit. He did not abandon us completely, and we don't have time to get all into the Holy Spirit and what that means for us and how that changes everything for our lives now. What I'm trying to focus on is the life of Jesus and how it is not complete. The fulfillment of this is not complete until he returns to us. Right, and so the disciples, they understood what Jesus was talking about when he says, "I go away and prepare a place for you, and I'm going to return," right? Because, right, this was kind of a normal analogy for them. This is exactly what would happen during a marriage, right? And we see this in Matthew chapter 25. We see this throughout the Old Testament as well, where what would happen is the groom, right, when they become betrothed, he would actually leave and go prepare a place for them to live. Essentially, he would build a house, right? And oftentimes, this was done on the father's estate, if not connected to the father's house, right? And so their family would have their house, whatever that is, and then when the son was about to get married, he would go build a house for him and his wife to live in, right? And so this was common practice. They understood this going away to prepare a place for them. Right, and then what the bride would do during this time is it says that she would prepare herself for marriage, right? And she would stay pure, and she would get her things ready as she gets ready to be married and go join a different family. But the interesting thing about our situation in this, right, Ephesians 5:27 actually tells us that Jesus, right, Jesus is going to prepare a house for us, but then Ephesians 5:27 actually tells us that Jesus is actually the one preparing his bride as well. He's preparing us. We're not preparing ourselves. We're not getting ourselves ready. Jesus, through his Holy Spirit, is preparing us for when he returns to bring us home with him. Right, so we have this God who is with us, who left for a time to prepare a place for us. And during the time that he's gone, he's preparing us. He's getting our hearts right. He's preparing us to be forever with him. Right? And I think this morning is somewhat like that. As we could be doing many other things this morning. We could be unwrapping presents. We could be getting together with family. But right now, as we're sitting here, we're preparing our hearts to be with him forever. We're remembering what today is all about. And our hearts are being prepared. Not necessarily because we're doing something, but God is doing something in us. All right, so God, Jesus, is preparing our hearts for him to come again. So then what happens when he returns? Right, he's going away for this little time so that he can come back, so that he can grab us, and we're being prepared, and then we're going to be with him forever. What does this second coming, what does this forever with him look like? Well, the second coming, and again, I just want to do another side note here. The book of Revelation is not some code that we have to, like, try and figure out when Jesus is coming back and figure out all the symbols. The main thrust of Revelation is the story reminding us that there is evil in this world and Jesus is coming back to fix that. Right, things are not as they should be. God is not done with his story, but the book of Revelation reminds us and kind of gives us a glimpse into the future of what God is going to do in order to finish his story, to be with us forever. All right, so what happens in the second coming? Well, we have this rapture meeting in the sky, and this is out of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18, and I kind of paraphrase some of this to make it a little bit smaller. It says this: we do not want you to be uninformed. So this is Paul writing to the Thessalonians, that you may not grieve as others do who do not have hope. Right? God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. Those who have died are going to be with God. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Right? I think sometimes as we talk about end times, as we talk about Jesus returning, it's kind of scary. It's kind of intimidating. It's kind of like, I kind of don't want that to happen because I like life now. But I love how he ends it. Encourage one another with these words. This is our hope. Right, when December 26th rolls around, when January 1st comes and we're looking at the daunting new year that's ahead of us, we have hope that we can encourage each other with the return of Christ, because this is when we will be with him forever. Our loved ones who have died, those who are way before us, we all get to be together forever with him. And he makes all things right. All right. So the first thing that's going to happen is Jesus is going to come back. We're all going to meet with him in the air and kind of, I don't know what we're going to do, give each other high fives, be like, woo, we made it. Doesn't necessarily say exactly everything, right? All we know is we're going to be with him. We're not going to ever be separated from him ever again. And so because of this, God throws a party. Right, this is Revelation chapter 19, verses 6 through 8. And essentially what happens here, I won't read the whole verse, but we're invited. It says, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. All right, so what's going to happen is just like a wedding analogy again, you go through the ceremony, and then afterwards we have the reception. right? Which is a time of celebration the ceremony has been complete. The couple is now one. And this is exactly the analogy that God is using of what we're going to do when we get to heaven. Right, what happens is we get caught up in the air, we come together, right? And throughout the Bible, we see these analogies of we are the bride of Christ, right? So essentially, when he comes back, it's as if that's the marriage ceremony. Now we are united with Christ forever. His bride has finally come to him. We are finally together, never to be separated again. So we throw a party. All right, we have this marriage supper of the marriage supper feast, right? And so now we're just throwing this big party. We're all eating together. We're all celebrating together. Right, this is, I think, going to be a super fun party. I think Jesus knows how to party. We see it all throughout the Gospels, right? What does Jesus do? He's like, hey, go get some food. Right? He loves to eat. He loves to have a table conversation and just celebrate with food. So this is going to be the biggest celebration that we've ever been to. Right? And so we get through this feast, and then there's obviously some judgment stuff that happens. We're not going to get too far into that. All we have to know as us in Christ, when we are judged on the seat, when God looks at us and looks at our deeds, he looks at Christ. Not us, right? And so that is a moment of celebration, right? Actually, the word judgment in the Greek, it actually has to do with almost in a, it's the same word is used in an award ceremony. When a runner wins a race, it's the judgment seat is where they get their crown of victory, right? That's what it's going to be for us. So we get to celebrate during that time as well. And then Revelation 21 actually tells us that there's going to be a new heavens and a new earth, right? It says, and then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and the sea was no more, and I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of the heavens that God prepared as a bride adorned for her husband, right? So God is going to create a brand new creation, which means all the pain, all the evil, all the suffering, all the things that are broken in this world are going to be washed away. And God is going to start anew. And we're going to be with him forever. We're going to celebrate with him forever. We're going to worship him forever. And again, I think sometimes we get in our mind as if we're just going to be doing nothing but sitting down and worshiping him, and it's going to get boring or whatever it is. I mean, I'm the youth pastor, right? I hear these kinds of things. Heaven and earth is not this like we're in clouds playing harps or anything like that. We're with God, right? And I think we're going to be doing things with him, right? We look at the garden, if that's any evidence of what heaven's going to be look like, and I think it is, they had tasks to do, right? What were they called to do? Hey, go tend to the fields. Go plant the plants, right? Heaven is going to be a renewed earth because God is with us. Right, it's this perfect restoration of a new life in Christ where I think we're going to be using our minds, we're going to be learning, we're going to be working, we're going to be celebrating. Right? Again, there's no curse over the land, there's no pain in our work. But it's going to be this glorious new physical place where the realms of heaven and earth met. And they forever are together because God is with us and is never going to leave again. We have this eternity with God. And again, why look forward to this? Right? God takes away all pain and evil. We are perfected in our body and our mind. We are perfected in our spirit. Right? Now I'm not super old. I can't say my age because the youth don't know how old I am, and I like to keep it that way. So if they ask you and you know, please don't tell them. But I'm getting to that point where there's things where my body's not able to do what it used to do, right? And as we get to heaven, I know some of you are laughing at me right now. You're like, he's so young. What are you talking? Jesus, come today. right? That this time when we're with Christ, our bodies will be perfected. We will not wake up with pain in our back or our knees or our ankles anymore. Our bodies will be perfected. That is something to look forward to. Our mind will be perfected. It's no longer going to think about the things we don't want to think about. It's no longer always going to go to the negative and never look at the positive. That will be renewed. It will be perfected. Right? And we're going to have life eternal, not just be alive. I think there's a difference in the Bible between being alive and having life. We're going to have life. Right? Jesus is life. He and again, as I said earlier, he gives life to people who are alive. Right? There's this distinction between that. And again, we don't have time to get into all of that, but life is better than being alive. We will have life in Jesus Christ for eternity. We will have total joy. No more sadness, no more pain. We will have perfect peace. This peace that we talked about last night, if you were here, it's going to stay with us forever, no matter what we're going through on earth. Sometimes it kind of comes and goes as we feel it. We will always feel perfect peace because we are with him. There is nothing else that we want. We'll have fellowship with each other and with God himself. I think it's 1 John chapter 1, verses 3 and 4 says something along the lines of, we have fellowship with one another because we have fellowship in Christ. Right? Because we are with him, we get to celebrate with each other every single day. That is something I look forward to. Right? Contentment. Contentment. What do you want here on earth? Right, so many people seek after riches, getting the new car, getting the big house. Why? Because we think that will fulfill us. We think that if I finally get this car, if I finally get this job, if I finally have this house, I will be satisfied. It's not true. Right? And there's countless stories everywhere of people who have gotten everything they wanted and they are not satisfied. We will have perfect satisfaction in heaven. We'll be perfectly satisfied. We will want nothing. We will be content because Christ is there with us, fulfilling every single need. You will never want anything ever again. All of this and more forever. It doesn't end. Right? It's not like Christmas where we look towards this with anticipation and then it's awesome and then it's over. Or even with Jesus' life on earth the first time, it's awesome. He does these great things. It's a little longer than Christmas Day, but then it's over. That's not going to happen this time. It's going to be forever. It's never going to end. It's going to be continual for all time. We will be with him. He will never leave us again. And everything that comes with the promises of Christ will be ours for all eternity. That is the day that we look forward to. Titus says it this way. In chapter 2, verse 11 through 13, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. So that's what we're doing now. But then look at this word, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Right? The word waiting here has a connotation of eagerly awaiting, anticipating something, kind of like we did most of this month for today, right? We're waiting for, there's this anticipation, there's this hope growing within us as each day draws closer. He says, this is how we are to be of the second coming of Christ. So as we celebrate today, we go home, we open gifts, we think of the birth of Jesus Christ, but we also look forward to the time when he comes again. As we're celebrating, maybe you're going to eat a meal tonight with family, as you're having that celebration and laughing and have joy and everything is perfect, I want you to think of the marriage supper of the Lamb that we will celebrate with Christ when he comes again and say, this is just a taste of what it's going to be like when he returns. Right, tomorrow morning when you wake up and we have to start tearing things down or taking out the garbage and washing the dishes, right? And Advent season is over, right? The word Advent means waiting. That is weeks before Christmas. That's over. But we are in an Advent season that lasts until Christ returns. And we look forward to that. Every day we can wake up and say, we are one day closer. We are one day closer to being with God forever, where all our hopes are fulfilled. We have joy. We have peace. We lack nothing. That is the day that we look forward to every single day as Christians when we wake up. If you do not have this hope this morning, if you do not know Jesus Christ, if you do not know what your future holds, I encourage you this morning, come to Christ. The promises that he, all the things that are promised of him, he does. Everything that we have talked about, this joy, this peace, this hope, it is found only in him. There is no other way. Come to Jesus this Christmas morning that you may have hope tomorrow when you wake up, the first of the year, as we're in some blizzard in February. You have hope because Jesus is coming again. And he will never leave us when that day comes. He never leaves us now. He's gone. He's preparing a place for us. But he hasn't left us alone, right? He left us the Spirit of God to live inside of us that we may eagerly await his return. This is good news, is it not? Amen. I'm going to invite the band back up. We're going to sing, I think, one more song. I'm celebrating this, but again, as you leave today, I want you to be thinking of these things that we look forward to as we celebrate on Christmas Day. We're not just, as Christians, we're not just celebrating what happened in the past. Again, that was phenomenal, right? Jesus coming is beyond what we can explain. There's so much awesomeness there, but we also look forward to the day he returns again to never leave us, to be united with our God and live with him forever. Would you guys pray with me? Father, we thank you again for all that you've done, for your goodness, how you love us, how you left us to go prepare a place, that you may come back and we may celebrate eternity with you. God, we love you. We praise you this morning for all you've done. In Jesus' name.
All right, let's all stand to our feet as we close together. And we are going to do one last thing. We will have the kids coming up for their presents, but I want to invite all the kids, and I think Liz is out there as well, to come up on stage and sing out this last song with us, Go Tell It on the Mountain. So if you're a child under the age of 12, let's come on up to the stage. Let's welcome them up, guys. Make them feel welcome. Come on, guys. Liz is going to bring some of the younger ones up as well. You guys can come stand up here with us. Anywhere you want on stage. You can buy the trees, buy the drums. Come on up. Make your way up. Come on, guys. Be brave. Yeah.
In the front.
Nice. Come on, guys. Fill in, guys. Come on up here up front. Go by Emily and Mary. There you go. Awesome. And you guys, we have a cheat sheet up there. See the words up on the screen? You guys can read those. You don't even have to look at this one because we have one back there. So we can read the words from back there. Sound good? All right.
Jesus Christ is born.
Let's sing out one more time.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
Yeah. Amen and amen. That does conclude our service. If there are any more kids out there, we invite you guys to come on up and grab your present. Liz and some of the volunteers will be handing those out for you guys. And Merry Christmas to all of you. Go in peace. We'll see you guys next week.
Woo.
Nice job, guys. High fives.
Woo.
Good son. Great. Nice. Good singing. Good job.